So these parameters, before going to these parameters definition and how they are used, let us talk something generic module, generic module concept. So that after that generic module concept, then we can come to that parameter definition and how it is used and all. So I have, for example, a module called adder or counter. Let us take counter. So this module is my counter module. I have written this counter for 3 bit. I have written this counter for 3 bit. So now what happens is, in future course of time, I want something with the maybe 5 bit and maybe 10 bit. For that matter, let us call it as a n bit counter. So we don't know whether we require a 5-bit counter or 10-bit counter. That's why we are just generalizing as a n-bit counter. So, but the problem is the code that we have written long ago, some time back. So that is fixed for 3-bit. That is fixed for 3-bit. Is there a way to make use this code? Here means answer is, no, we cannot use this code. Reason is, this is the very description is done here for this 3-bit. Description is done for 3-bit. So this code is fixed for 3-bit. Now the point is there a way, instead of fixing the number of bits, so if we generalize this one, it's called a generic module. Say, generic module. So we want to make this module generic, not fixed. Unlike this fixed one, we want to make that module as a generic. This is fixed. So we don't want this fixed type. So what we want is this generic we want. So how do we make? At that point, your parameters will play a role. The parameters, this parameter keyword will play a role. So you can make any module workable at that point of time for your required number of bits. In course, future course of time, if you are switching from that to other, then that is very much possible. Then that is very much possible with the help of this parameter keyword. That is the point number one that we have to understand. What is generic module? Generic module is a one. When we describe the module, we will not fix its size, the number of bits. Suppose in case of a 4-bit adder, we are not going to fix that for 4-bit. Counter example, we are not going to fix it for 3-bit. So we are generalizing it. So that is called generic module. This generic module capability comes through this parameter. That is the point number one. Point number two is, in your test bench, somewhere you have mentioned some delay. How do you mention delay? Yesterday we have seen that example, that is the test bench development example. In that, there is a hash. With this hash, we are putting some numerical value. So what was called this hash in the Verilog terminology? This is delay control operator. That we have seen yesterday. Okay, delay control operator. So later on in your test bench, you started your test bench something like this. You started with writing a module, because anything in a Verilog starts with a module, and then inside whatever that comes here. But at the end, you have to have your end module. Now here somewhere you have hash 5. Later on, you thought, no, I don't want this delay. I want something else. So that way you thought. So everywhere, wherever this phi is there, throughout your code here, throughout code here, you have to change, keep changing. Instead that, if you mention here parameter, and then some delay, say that is D1, we are named, we are giving the name, instead of phi, we are giving it D1 there. And that is phi. At once you change here, wherever the D1 is there, everywhere that is applicable. Everywhere that is applicable. So that is the second advantage. There also we can use. And at this point, what I want to mention is, I want to mention about compiler directive. There is a compiler directive. That compiler directive already we have discussed in introductory classes. The compiler directive, any compiler directive will start with a backcode. This backcode on your keyboard, there is a tab key. Above the tab key, you will find this backcode. And then you are writing something called define. So that is a macro. You are defining a macro. So let us say that macro is D1 and you are placing a phi. So anywhere this D1 is used inside this code here, anywhere this D1 is used, there where this phi is substituted. So it's a macro definition. That we carry with the help of this compiler directive. So there is a difference having compiler directive in our code and having this parameter in our code, this parameter usage in our code. So that point I will make later sessions, what why we don't prefer define and when we prefer define. So those discussions will be carried later later sessions. But the current point we are discussing is a parameter. You have to understand this generic module is something. Later, we can use this for any number of bits. We can alter 4-bit can be now. It, instantly, suppose I want 100-bit adder. I don't need to develop the code actually for 100-bit adder. So I simply make use this already developed code, and I alter something in this code that is currently is a 4-bit adder. I alter something here with the help of this parameter. So that alternation, making such changes is very much possible with the help of this keyword called parameter. So in that sense, this 4-bit module currently has become a generic module. So it is generalized. It is for anything, not only 100, for any number. Likewise, counter example. Currently, it may be for 3-bit. In future course, N-bit if you want, you can very much change that using this parameter. That is the main prime focus of today's lecture, how this is used. So that is, with that said, your brief idea that you got how powerful this parameter is, how powerful this generic module is, with these two basic background, let us move to this discussion. In this discussion, some statements, some definitions, we'll just go through because those are required for understanding. Parameters are Verilog constructs that allow a module to be reused with a different specification, nothing but generic module. I was talking about reused, meaning later time, maybe N-bit counter. So I just want to reuse the earlier development. So that is the point. With a different specification. Earlier it was 3-bit counter, now with a different specification, with N-bit. So that is the whole point here, this one. For example, the example provided, a 4-bit adder can be parameterized. With this parameterized, one more terminology is the parameterized module. This one I was telling generic module. This generic module is also called parameterized module. It is a parameterized module. Remember this one. You either can call it as a generic module or a parameterized module. So that parameterized module, this one. So generic module is also known as a parameterized module. So four-bit adder can be parameterized to accept a value for the number of bits, and new parameter values can be passed in during module instantiation. So how do we change that from 4-bit adder to any number of? That is through module instantiation. How do we instantiate module? That we will see in this current session. So this is elaborated further. So an n-bit adder can become 4-bit, 8-bit, or 16-bit, or any number here, etc. So this n-bit is actually parameterized. That is generic module or parameterized. They are like arguments to a function that are passed in during function call. Those who are familiar with C programming or any other programming languages where procedure calls are there, where functions are there, we pass to that function some arguments. So it is something like that. We pass something, we define the module with the n. Later on, when required as a 4, as a 8, as a 16, these numbers we pass to this generic module, this parameterized module. Since we are passing that way, it resembles like to function we are passing some values. That way, in that sense, it is. They are like arguments to a function that are passed during a function call. Parameters are basically constants, and hence it is illegal to modify their value at runtime. So there are two terminologies in the software. Guys, never ever have an impression Verilog HDL is like you are learning a programming. You are learning a how to describe your hardware. Basically, you are a digital IC designer going to be if you master this HDL. So never ever think that you are learning C sort of language. Okay, but still at the abstract level, higher abstraction level, it seems like you are learning a program. But more you have to think how hardware works. In that way, you develop a good RTL code. The reason why I mentioned here is this point: this runtime. There are two terminologies in the software domain. One is the runtime, the other is the compile time. So compile time means when we write a program during that, we convert this, we check the lexicals, convention, syntax, all that is correct or not, that is the compile. Runtime, when it is really performing something, execution, at that time if it is prompting, the runtime. So these parameters never will happen, a case will not happen when it is program is running, like it will not prompt you to enter the parameter value n, whether you want it to be 8 or 16. That way it is not going to prompt at the runtime. That is called runtime actually. So it is more at a compile time, meaning it's a constant. So no confusions here to the new guys, the learners. Just understand that there is a term called runtime. You have to remember, interview point of view, this is important, because can parameter be changed during runtime? If that's the question for as a HDL, you are appearing to the interview, answer is no. Why? Because parameters are basically constants, and constants cannot be changed during runtime. That's the answer. So hopefully that's clear. It is illegal to redeclare a name that is already used by a net. This point we have to remember. These are some rules that we have to follow. That parameter, we declare, wait a moment. Here, let me go. If you go here, you declare something like in your, you have module, and some code here. And then there is a n module. Somewhere here you are declaring your parameter. So So that is a parameter, and you give some name. Let us say that is again. Let us say d1 equal to of 1, and you have put a semicolon. And this d1 we are talking about d1. This d1 might not have declared, might not have been declared anywhere as a net, as a variable, or in or another parameter. There shouldn't be another parameter with the same name. So net means, you know, net type. So far several nets we have seen. If you are not remembering, if you are not able to recollect, kindly refer those already pre-recorded videos that I have shared with you. So net is that. Variable is that register data type. Anyway, basically net and variable are data types. So in these data types, if user has defined something, like just now in the paint I have shown D1, it's already been declared to a net. That such a variable defined associated with a net cannot be declared again for the parameter, or it cannot be declared if one parameter already using, the other parameter cannot have the same name. That's the break point here. So this rule we have to abide by. This rule. So there are two major types of parameters. One is a module parameter. There is a specify. This specify we will take up in unit 5, where we talk much about the delays. So at this instant of time, what you have to remember is two types of parameters are there. One is a module, the other is with specify parameters. You know the module that we describe any code, module and module. So in that the parameter if used, that is called module parameter. There is a specify and specify keyword is there. We use it mostly like for delays, timing issues. For that to test, we use specify and end specify keyword. That one I take up elaborately later on. The current that issue we are dealing with is a module and module in between. If how do we write a parameter? That is the current issue. But for awareness, these parameters are also used in a specify. Those are different. Those are different from this module parameter. So this one I will take up in the 5th unit or 4th unit. Syllabus already shared with you. So, but at this instant, there are two types of parameters, module and specify. And both access a range specification. We also can declare the range for them, like for example, over here. So this parameter is a D1 is a 5. There is a no range mentioned here with the D1. Basically, compiler itself is depending upon the this constant here. Suppose if I have here 16. So what is this 5 is there? So by default, as in the previous sessions it is discussed, compiler by default, if you have installed on 32-bit machine, so for this, it will going to allocate 32 bits. For 64-bit host system, if you have installed compiler, then for this, it is going to allocate 64 bits. Meaning other than this value 101, actually, which is good for this file, other than that, all that unnecessary zeros will be mentioned by the compiler. So we can instruct the compiler, Baba, you don't burden yourself with these extra zeros. You just take only this required amount of bits. So that is the size I can put here, telling like 2:0. Nothing but 0, 1, 2. Nothing but 3 bits. 0, 1. So this is 3 bits. I can tell the compiler that this range only you allocate for this number. Got that? So that is the size here. That is the range specification we are talking about. Coming to this point here, but they are normally made as wide as the value to be stored requires them to be, and hence a range specification is not necessary. This is important, linked with this point. Range is actually not required. By default, compiler will do the job. But if you want to be more perfectionist sort of, so in that case you can happily, Verilog compiler is facilitating for you range specification also. So that's what the point, this point is. But they are normally made, what made these parameters are made normally as wide as the value to be stored. That phi is there, no? Phi 101, that is enough. So parameter is clever enough to look into. So that way, that will manage. So that is what we have demonstrated even in this one. This is going to do anyway. These unnecessary zeros, it will create depending upon the host system that you have declared. But required value, it is managing. You don't need to bother. Required value is managed by the compiler automatically. Though you did not mention this size, that range, this range. So that is doing it automatically. But if you want to be more precise, that I don't want this extra to be burdened by the compiler, I just want to instruct the compiler only this thing, that also is feasible. That is what the point that we are making here with this. So this is about parameters. For some examples here, you have this keyword parameter, and there is this MSV. This is user defined. There is no keyword, nothing. You just thought of having like that constant. Anywhere that in the code that you want to use, MSV you want to use anywhere. So you have put a MSV there. So, and this is the value that is associated, and terminate with a semicolon. This is important. It's a syntax. If you don't terminate with a semicolon, then it will throw error. So this is also possible. This one we have seen. Real and all that we have seen in the introductory classes. So this is also possible, such numbers like 4.5. So with the keyword, this is real. Now parameter, this one here, multiple, if you see here, this one, FIFO underscore depth and this max underscore width. Here one, two, there are two constants here. But we are using a single keyword parameter. How we are managing? We are separating them with a comma here. So that is also possible. So you can use multiple constants here with a single keyword, provided you have to separate them with a comma. And the last one you have to end with a semicolon. That is the syntax of this Verilog HDL. So this is about the range that we just now, a while ago, we spoke about this one. So if you see here, 2 tick B, 3, but if you see carefully this one here, we are actually 2 bits only we are asking here for representing this 3. There is some mistake here, because it shouldn't be the case here. If you remember this B, in the base format system, we have seen in earlier previous sessions, it should not come with a B here. Why? Because if it is coming with a B, the problem is you are allowed to have here 1 and zeros only. Here D is allowed. D is allowed because it's a D is for decimal. H is allowed. It's a hexadecimal. 0 to 9 and then 10 to 15, A. B, C, D, F, like that allowed, if hexa is used here. If octal is used, then also is allowed. There is a correction here. So, but the point here that what I am making is, 2-bit value is converted to 8 bits, that is 8-bit B3, just because this one is the range, if you see, 0 to 7, nothing but 8 bits. Since we are asking, instructing compiler, Baba, this value needs to be represented with a 8 bits. So that's the reason why internally it is converting instead 2 bits, though you have mentioned 2 bits. But since you have mentioned the range, internally to represent this value of 3, total 8 bits are used. That is 1, 1 and rest all zeros. So that way, this is the range specification. This way you mentioned the range. So now coming to this one here, the other. Module parameters can be used to override parameter definitions within a module, and this makes the module have a different set of parameters at compile time. So how do we override? That is the point here. How do we alter the parameter value? So this parameter value we can alter using keyword DEFPARAM, def, define parameter. It's a keyword, this one, where I'm hovering my mouse, DEFPARAM, say keyword in the Verilog HDL. With the help of this keyword def param, that is define parameter, keyword it is, we have to use to alter the parameter value that is already declared. Or the other way around is module instance statement. Through module instantiation, we can alter this parameter value. How we alter through def param usage, and how do we alter through module instance, we are going to learn now in subsequent slides. So it is a common practice to use uppercase letters in names for the parameters to make them instantly noticeable. This is the standard industry practice, guys. Parameter up, there is no standard rule that we have to use uppercase alone, but that's how the industry practices. So if you have this one, that is you are mentioning something here, parameter, and you are developing a state machine. Your state machine has got total three states, let us say S0 and S1 and S2. So these are the states, let us say. So now you are using here for S0 something that is 0, comma. For S1 you are using 1, for S2 you are using 2. So here what is emphasized is, you don't, just be careful, don't use lowercase, use uppercase S. That's the standard practice. Use this uppercase S1. Use this uppercase S2. Like that. So that is the standard practice, and for readability also it will be good. But we have to remember this is how the industry practices. So the module shown below uses parameters to specify the bus width. One is bus width, the other is data width and depth of repo within the design, and can be overridden with the new values when the module is instantiated or by using def param statements. Overwriting or overridden is done with the help of this instantiation, I've said here, module instance statement, or this is, or this def para, using def para. Let us see how that is done. This is Verilog 1995 style port declaration. So this must be clear for you, everyone there, especially new learners. 1995 port declaration, and there is another Verilog 2001 style port declaration. So this, there must not be any confusion. Let me clear this confusion first, if there is any to the newcomers. Verilog 1995 style port declaration, in that you first list the port, all ports that are there with your module. You list them. First two ports, so your primary ports, primary input ports and primary output ports. Basically, your primary ports, you mention, you list them here. That is port list area. Later on, you identify these identifiers to which they belong to. Like this ADDR belongs to input, and this R data here somewhere, this R data belongs to output. So you are associating to which port type they belong here separately. It's called port declaration area. This area is called port declaration area. So this is done according to Verilog 1995 style port declaration. According to Verilog 2001 style port declaration, this entire thing, you know, this you see here, a complete thing. Imagine this complete thing inside here, inside parenthesis. Inside parenthesis, you just imagine. is completing. Provided the semicolons are not there, you are separating everything like input ADDR, comma, and then you are coming to input W data, comma, input write, comma, and then this input select, comma, output R data. Then this is also you are not putting there inside here. Then close this parenthesis and then semicolon. So the imagine this entire thing inside here, and you don't need to have again here. You don't need to have again here. Port declaration is not required. Once for all inside everything, port to type declaration and port list also happening inside only inside this parenthesis. So that is called Verilog 2001 style port declaration. Okay, so now let us proceed with our this example, this one, how we are overriding this through module instantiation and using defined parameters. So here if you see carefully, parameter bus width is declared as a 32, comma, we are not going to use with bus width, data width, before depth. With all these constants, we are not going to use separate parameter keyword here. That's why we are separating with a comma, comma, and the last one is terminated with a semicolon. This is the syntax I was talking about earlier here somewhere. This third one, if you see, comma, and then terminating with a semicolon. In such case, you don't need to have separate parameter with this and then with this. If you are going to have separate parameter, then you have to terminate this one with a semicolon, and then again you start here parameter, and then this one, and then this whatever this is. That's how here. So now, having declared these constants here, then we are using here. If you see this wire, I am not going to put this bus width that is 32 minus one, nothing but 31. The 31 I am not going to keep straight here, this numerical value. Instead this numerical value, I am going to use this bus width constant, that bus width. Later in future course of time, if you want to alter, you alter here, automatically it will be updated here. You alter 64 automatically, this data width wherever you have used here, data underscore width, the data underscore width twice you have used here. If you alter here once, here everywhere wherever that data width is there, that is altered. Now before underscore depth, that is also the same here, before underscore depth here, 512. So total 512, this is array type, so this is memory, so we have 0 512. If you put here, what is that happening? 0 to 511, every location has got 8 bits. That's the meaning. So that we will discuss later on, but the point here what I'm making is how you use them. That's how you use them. And the design code goes here. So that this design IP, this is the intellectual property. IP means intellectual property. So you are describing some FIFO or some hardware, whatever, that is your intellectual property. So that one, that logic goes here. So now coming to this one here, how you are going to override this one, this bus width, data width, or FIFO width. Let us see with this example here. In this example here, what is presented is not overwriting, not this matter hasn't yet come. This matter hasn't yet come. This one module through module instantiation or through def param, we are going to override this parameter value. That point is not yet come here. This point is about the other way of declaring this parameter. As I said, I was telling you about Verilog 1995 style port declaration and Verilog 2001 style port declaration. I spoke here about this port list. It will not be there. Imagine this entire thing is coming here, and this semicolon will not be there, comma, 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 and this will not be there, the semicolon, and you close this parenthesis and then terminate semicolon. It's about port. It's about port. But now this parameter is also possible like this, according to 2001, that is called ANSI style. According to 2001, called ANSI style. So So in this ancestor, what we are doing carefully, if you observe here, if you go back here, this one, keep in mind here. I would have kept a side by side that one, but for a while, just keep in mind. Here, first what we have done, module and the port list and the parameter has come here, right? Now what we are doing, just imagine, just keep this one in mind. I would have kept the side by side. Here, what we are doing, module design_IP has come. Just in between this parenthesis, beginning and ending parenthesis, it was there in a previous layer, straight it has come here. In between that portion, before parenthesis and this module name, in between that, we put here this way, that is with a hash. You know hash, where it has come in, it is as a delay operator. So that hash is used. And you open the parenthesis. Inside the parenthesis, you use the keyword parameter, and then your constants here. All right. Now you close. Once you have done with that, you close this one here. So this is called ANSI style Verilog code declaration. In that, the parameter declaration is done in this ANSI, like it's a 2001 language standards. It is done like that. So. Instead here, we are doing in between here, this design IP space, and here we are putting this one hash, open the parenthesis, you put this one inside here and close the parenthesis, and you have this port here. And port, inside port, you instead 1995, you put everything, this one here. In that case, everything is becoming according to language 2001 standards. Current compiler will happily accept 1995 this style also, no issues with that. But we should be knowing, if you see somewhere some code like this, there shouldn't be any confusion. This is simply according to language 2001, that's it. But compiler is still this way also. If you are writing, compiler is not going to throw any error. So that is the point that I am trying to make. Now we are coming to that overriding parameter. This overridden with the new values when module is instantiated or by using def parameter, that is coming now. Overriding parameter, how we override this one. So parameter can be overridden with the new values during module instantiation. This we have seen. Let us straight go to the point here, because already we have seen this several times, module instantiation or using def par. So let us go to the example. Straight. You see the module instantiation override. Here it is done like this. You know, yesterday you have seen test bench, where you have the module and test here. It was test there. Yesterday's example, semicolon, and straight after inside whatever that is done, you are coming to end module. So inside that, you instantiated yesterday HA, your half adder module name. When you are instantiating, you have to come this way, something like this, hash, open the parenthesis. Inside this parenthesis, you want to alter. Suppose you want to alter bus width and data width. Earlier, if you see here, in this case, what we have bus width 32, and what we have here, data width 64. Then we want to alter. So what we are doing, we are updating this bus width with 64, that was earlier 32. Now data width is with a 128, that was earlier 64. So we have updated these values. When we instantiated that, what you have instantiated, this design IP. Where is this design IP? You already have written your entire code here, your module, your design IP, code is going. This is according to 2001. If you go back here, according to 1995. So according to 95 or 2001, whatever, design code goes here. Your logic, entire logic is going here based on your bus width, based on your data width. You're developing your entire logic here. This entire logic now, can be altered this depending upon this one. This is totally now changing, taking a new hardware, right? Earlier it was working for bus width of 32, data width of 64, but now it is working for this one, bus width of 64, data width of 1000. Did you develop separately for bus width 64, data width 120, a new code did you develop? No, we did not develop any new code. The code is already existing for bus width 32, data width for 64, already existing this entire code. But later in future course of time, I thought, my bus width should be 64, my data width should be 128. So at that time, you did not, you are not going to start from scratch again developing the code. You simply use it that very code, already developed code, but you simply providing, you are updating the constants there. So that's called parameterized module. That is what I was telling in earlier slides. Parameterized module, generic module. So which one is a generic module now? Which one is a parameterized module now? This one is not a parameterized module. Anyone new thing that is going to you change here, alter with the help of this one. This design IP is a parameterized module. This one. This entire design module to end module, your complete hardware, one hardware. This design IP is a parameterized module, or it's a generic module. So that one, with the help of instantiation, we are overriding this value. Now let us see with the help of def param how we are going to override. You use here def param keyword, this one, observe carefully. Now what you are doing is,
sir, I have it out.
Yes
sir, I have it out.
Yes,
yeah, in 1995 model also you can use the same thing.
Can you repeat?
Yeah, like there are two models, right? 2001 model and 95 model. Yeah, in 95 model also we can use the same instantiation.
Yes.
It's not there in the port, like that the delay operator is not there. Even though in that case also we can use, like.
This one you are talking about, right? Let me put forth your question once. If I took your question correctly or not, you tell me. Your question is,
yeah.
Your question is this, that you said 1995 style port. You kindly unmute yourself kindly mute. Okay, thank you. So now I'll be talking about your question now. If I am wrong, then you unmute yourself and talk. If I am correct, then let us proceed. You say once you unmute and you say, yeah, that question is correct. The question is, according to 1995, the port declaration is like this, that we have port list and then port type here. According to 2001, we have inside the parenthesis itself like this, the port type also is there and port list is also is there. That is one thing, and these parameters are declared in this way, and in according to 1995 parameters are declared in this way. So in either case, is this applicable, that's the question. Yeah, am I correct?
Yes, that's the question. Yeah,
okay. Yes, answer is yes, that is applicable. This is applicable, but in both cases, this overriding parameter, this approach in this design IP, that is the module that you are instantiating here. You instantiated here, right? Design_IP. You go back here, you have design_IP. This one, design_IP. This is according to language 2001 standards. Now you have design IP here. It is according to 1995. But in either case, what is our module? This design underscore IP is our module. This design underscore IP module we are instantiating here. In that case, if that instantiated module is, let us say, I have developed like this, the other person has developed like this. So in either case, can we alter, can we update this bus build and data build in this way of writing here the way we've shown? Answer is yes. We can, this is the way that we update the values. Either that module that you are instantiating here, that module may be 1995 style or 2001 style, but the way that we override the parameters is, one is module instantiation, the other is using def param, this keyword. So this either way is applicable for the module that you have instantiated. It may be 1995 style or according to 2001 style, no problem. But we can update these values, these constants, in this fashion. So that is a hope the one who asked, hope your question is answered. Can you
yes, it's clear.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. So let us continue. In I was talking about, we are here two ways we can override. One is a module instantiation, the other is this keyword. So using module instantiation, how we are overriding? This way we are overriding. Yesterday we have seen half adder, HA, and then straight there, what we have seen yesterday, there is instantiation name, and then here port list, this port list. So the point here is, in between this hash, parenthesis, and that particular constant that we want to change. In this case, if you see, we are trying to target bus width and data width, but if you see the constants here, we have bus width, data width, and FIFO def. Three are there. So we are specifically mentioning the constants which we want to alter. We want to alter bus width and data width. So this one we did not mention. Where here? Here we did not mention. So compiler is default going to take the same FIFO width. So that one we have to keep in mind. This is one point of the guys there, carefully listen. Since we did not mention, that is going to take default that 512 there, before it. In our example, it was a 512. Now let us take one more case. I did not mention, orally I will talk about. I am putting here first 64, then 128, and the third one I am not mentioning. So in that case, guys, the order is important. This order, it is going to apply in this order. Like first is 64, then the other is 128. So since I mentioned two, so it is going to update them in order. So the third one I did not mention. So it is going to keep the third one as it is. So that is the positional that we will see. Don't go panic, but just I am mentioning. But I will take up example. Don't go panic. Not to confuse you guys. Just leave that matter now, what I spoke. You just understand that you have instantiated your module here. That way, the way yesterday we have demonstrated half adder, and straight we have gone to the port list in the half adder case. But remember, one point we have to remember. What is that important point that we have to remember is, in 1995, simply you have listed no ports here. You listed ports here. But according to 2001 style, you inside parenthesis, you even have kept input keyword, and then this variable identifier, ADDR address, this user defined identifier. So, but the moment when you are trying to instantiate here this port list, you if you have written the in 2001, you should not be writing again input or output keywords also. Only identifiers are required. Remember, that's the point that is important. Guys may be thinking, somebody some newcomers, this is since 2000, since it is 1995, so we have listed the ports here. So that fellow, the one who is delivering this lecture, said in this should come. So according to 1995, this according to 2001, inside we have the keyword input. So possibly when we are instantiating, since I had developed my code using 2001, so I have to have even input here. Are you getting the guys their point, what I'm trying to make? So whatever that is 1995 or 2001, simply port identifier should come here. Port identifiers only. If you have mentioned in 2001, in 2001, you mentioned inside the this list, your keywords, input and outputs, everything. Be careful. While you instantiate here, you are not going to instantiate with the keywords as well. You are going to instantiate with only port identifiers. This should be clear, okay? So that if you have any doubts, you can unmute. But I think I made it clear, this one, what I'm trying to make a point here. But this point is also clear to you now. The only thing you are updating this constants in this way. The syntax is hash, open the parentheses, and what parameters that you want to update, mention them, and with what value that you want to update, that you mention. That's it. You are ready to go. You updated. This is through module instantiation. Now coming to def param. Now def param. So this def param, if keyword have used here, this d0, you see d0. What is this d0, guys? It's the instantiation name, right? So this instantiation name dot, and this particular what you want to alter. You want to alter, in this example we provided FIFO depth. This is FIFO depth. This is the FIFO depth. Only this we are targeting. That is, instead 512, we are targeting 128. We are updating with a 128. So it means what? In this case, in this particular case, we are not touching this bus width and data width. Only we are touching FIFO depth. So only this is being updated, 128. And the others will be like this bus width will be 32, and data width will be 64. If we want to update even this, then what is that we have to do here? Here we have to put a comma or have one more def param, and then d0 again, this d0 dot, and then this time you put a bus width equal to whatever the value. Suppose in this case you want the 64 again, the same 64. Then semicolon. One more def param, then d0. And then this time you want to alter this data underscore width also. So put a d0 dot data underscore width that is equal to, let us say that is somewhere 28 only, suppose. So 28. So the guys, these two are the essential things with which we alter the constants. So these are the ways I will demonstrate, but at this point, I hope so far what all we have discussed are clear. That is one thing that I'm trying to get from you people input, that what all so far I have discussed is clear. The second thing is to get you people hands-on how to use them. I will demonstrate a lot of examples, like some counter example, some MUX example, some other examples I will take, and I will demonstrate by simulating here, and also will be providing some assignments to you. So at your leisure time, you can practice. So with that said, and we are close to 9 now. So